So this has been an interesting phenomenon for a party in power to party. That party leaves, and the opposition party comes in and is going to want to pursue different policies that benefit those people, those Americans, as opposed to the ones that were being benefited before. That was quite a phenomenon. We called our democracy, our constitution, our federation, the great experiment. And this is phenomenal. No one's really done this yet. I mean, it's experimental what we're doing. And I will say this about the early period of our republic, if I haven't stressed it yet, but between Washington and Madison, first 25 years of the American Republic is probably our most vulnerable period as far as other than the Civil War, other than that, it's a very vulnerable time for our republic. And in fact, that is the topic of an essay that you may wish to write on. It's the first one on the back, and we've kind of already gotten into it. I'm going to read through that. During the administrations of Washington, Adams, Jefferson, and Madison, the U.S. faced a number of threats to the continuation of its union. Trace the history of this period, looking at the development of the first party system, so the Federalists and all their interests and their policies under Hamilton, versus the Jeffersonians, which are known as the Democratic Republicans. Now, the political acts that caused grief to the opposing party. So can y'all think of any policies that the Federalists passed that really irritated the Democratic Republicans while they were in power? I know it's been 2 weeks, but if you look back, I guess you could look at your ID list from, say, Report on Manufacturing through about the Kentucky Resolution. Well, what are some things that the Federalists did that the party out of power cried foul over? Which one? Yes, indeed. Both of which were to benefit the Federalists, politically speaking, the alien, to keep immigrants from being able to vote for 14 years because they knew they'd vote for the other party, and then the Sedition Act, which undermined the First Amendment, freedom of speech. That drove the party out of power crazy. And then if you look at the next part, it says, the actions taken by the parties out of power. So what did the Federalists, what did the Democratic Republicans do in response to the Sedition Act? What's the corresponding action taken by the Democratic Republicans? The Kentucky Resolutions, right? They said the federal law would not be enforced in the state of Kentucky. Virginia did the same thing. Well, they're going to stress states' rights in opposition to the federal power because they're not the party in power. And you're going to see that in the switch that takes place, now the Democratic Republicans are going to do things that the Federalists don't like, and the Federalists are going to take some actions too, trying to block it. The party in power, party out of power, and the frustration that they feel towards each other. And then finally, the resolution of these crises, including the crisis of war with England, also including the competing political visions of Hamilton and Jefferson. It's quite an essay, a lot to work with. I think you should bring in Marbury versus Madison. That's one of the things that could speak to this. Madison, you gonna be all right tonight? You look so sleepy. All right. You want to go get a Coke or something next door? You're good? Okay. Let's get into it. All right, this one's pretty easy. You all heard about this when you were in junior high, maybe earlier. And it's the purchase of this vast piece of territory. Not from the Native Americans, and they weren't involved in this bargain, but from the claims of the French. The French had claimed, first they tried to challenge, sorry, police band-aids on me. They tried to challenge the Americans and the British for this period, right? The 7 Years' War ejected them from this territory, but they maintain a claim to this Western territory. So I'm going to complicate this. I'm going to make it much more complicated than it was when you heard about this in junior high. See if I can turn this on. Jefferson, in his administration, And you, by the way, the ID for this is Livingston. Livingston's first name. Robert Livingston, I think it is. Robert Livingston. I'm going to hang the Louisiana Purchase on this Livingston fellow. We have crossed the Appalachian Mountains, and we have moved into Indiana and Ohio and Illinois and Kentucky. And we are beginning to farm here. Now, this is about the most fertile land on the world, right? This is among, I can't think of a place in the world that's more fertile than this right here. It's the breadbasket of, I guess the Ukraine maybe. The breadbasket of America is here. Not only can we feed ourselves, we also feed a lot of other people in the world out of this. So we're going over here. We're beginning to move into a commercial farming. Not farming as yeoman farmers who are growing everything they need, like up in Appalachian Mountains in some valley where you grow everything and you can it. That's not where we're moving to. We're moving towards commercial farming. We're growing a lot of staple commodities like corn, wheat. I suppose, I don't know if they grew soybeans then or not. But anybody been through Illinois, driven through there? You've been to, what do you see everywhere? If you can see anything, all you see is 12 feet corn, right? As you drive along where you see soybeans. It is crazy out there. Now, are they going to sell it to each other, all this corn? The people in Indiana are going to say, hey, you want to buy some of my corn? No, where are they going to sell it? They're going to sell it over here in New England. This is the most densely populated part of America. By this point in time, by the way, it remains the most densely populated part of America. There's a great number of people, and the price of corn and wheat's rather high. So, how are you going to get it from here to there? Are you going to take it across the mountains on a little road with corn, like with horses and wagon? Why wouldn't that be viable? It takes about 3 weeks to travel on little paths with a horse, horses. Why wouldn't that be a very viable approach? The roads are bad, and so what would the expense of shipping would make the price of corn by the time you got it from Ohio to Boston? It would be more expensive than they can make it in Boston, so it's economically unviable. We need, I don't know if you'll know, but water transportation is the best because of buoyancy. It can carry, it can displace a lot of weight. What's the answer? How are you going to get it here? There's no Erie Canal yet, by the way. That's coming. The answer is this long, snaky looking thing. Mississippi River. There's rivers connecting to the drain into the Mississippi River. And farmers out here, well, actually more than just farmers, it's gonna be what are called factors and brokers out of New England are gonna travel out here to buy up these commodities, and they're going to borrow money, by the way, to do that, and they're going to ship it down the Mississippi River or have it shipped down the Mississippi River where it comes out where? New Orleans. And then it's got to be transported from barges that float on the river to ocean-going vessels, sails, schooners and such, that would then bring it around from through the Gulf and all the way back up here. Long route, right? To get things there, but that's the only economically viable element to it. Now, New Orleans had been in the hands of the Spanish for a very long time, but Napoleon Bonaparte has taken over Spain in 1805, be a little bit earlier than that. Well, it must be earlier than that because we've got 1803 here. I think 1799 he became emperor of France. So it just so happens that New Orleans is now in the possession of the French. Now, we're in a very vulnerable position with regard to this commodities because this port can be closed to us at any time. In fact, it had been closed to Americans before. So, because of that, when New England financiers loan money to factors and jobbers to go out and make the contracts to get this food, they charge a high price for credit because there's a chance that this thing can go south, right? Completely. They could lose all of the investment if this food can't get out of New Orleans and it all rots. So because of the high interest rates, the development of the Western Territory is retarded. It's slowed down. And the movement of Americans is not taking place as quickly because the viability of all that land is tied to the ability to get the food out of that territory. And that is impacted by the availability of getting it out of New Orleans. So Jefferson's administration proposes to buy New Orleans. New Orleans is what we're interested in. And really just Louisiana. And he sends Robert Livingston. He goes ahead and gets a pre-authorization from Congress. And y'all can look at the numbers for me. I think he's authorized to spend about $8 million for this purchase of New Orleans and Louisiana from the French. Robert Livingston and another group of American diplomats. By the way, he's called an envoy. We didn't have full ambassadors, but Robert Livingston is the envoy, not the car, the envoy, but I suppose the envoy, the car, is patterned off the idea of I don't know what, but an envoy is somebody who represents a government. Today, we usually talk about ambassadors or secretaries of state whose tenure may not be that long. So, when Robert Livingston gets there, Napoleon Bonaparte has an audience with them. Did you find the number?
15.
Is what he's authorized to spend on it?
That's what he actually bought it for.
Yeah, he's authorized for much less than this. He's authorized for about $8 million to buy this right here, maybe even $5 million. Well, they make the proposition to Napoleon Bonaparte to buy this piece of property for like $5 million. He says, why don't y'all go enjoy Paris and come back next week and we'll talk about it. They come back a week later, he says, I'm agreeable to selling this piece of property, but I'm also selling all of this French land claims to North America. You gotta buy the whole thing, not just. And it makes perfect sense, right? Why would the French hold on to it? What, they could never get to that property, right? If they sell their access point. And he offers the whole thing for $15 million. Livingston says, where do I sign? And Livingston goes ahead and commits the United States to this purchase through a treaty, sails back across the ocean, gets to Thomas Jefferson, comes running up the steps of the White House and says, fantastic news, selling the whole thing for $15 million. Jefferson says, I think that's cause for champagne. I hope you brought some with you. Now, it's a treaty. So Jefferson signs it. Is that it?
No.
What did you say? No, that's not it? What happens now?
There's Congress.
There you go. Where? Keep going.
The Senate.
The Senate, because a treaty is binding on the states, right? On all 50, well, by remaining states, there were 20 states. Then the states have a chance to, they've got to ratify it. So I'd like you to know that the Federalists oppose this. The Federalists oppose the purchase of this land from France. They want to block the deal. I think they even go so far as to say, show us in the Constitution. They basically say it's unconstitutional. Now, the reason that they do this, I've already given you the demographic type of the Federalist, right? Where do we find a Federalist?
In cities.
In cities. They're involved in commerce. They're along the ports. What kind of state, what's going to be the economy of these states if they emerge, when we anticipate that they would emerge there? What would the economies of these states be?
Agrarian.
What political parties would they be? What political party identification would these states probably have been when they send them to Washington is going to be Jeffersonian. And the Federalists are like, oh my God, we're stuck in a country with nothing but agriculture, so we're going to be overwhelmed. We'll never have power again. We'll never have policies again that will benefit us. And that's why they don't want it. The country's getting too big. Yes?
They hate France.
They hate France. They do. Well, Napoleon, they might not be so upset about if he protects property the way he did. But over the opposition of the Federalists, the Senate ratifies this thing, and we get the property. And then he sends out a couple of expeditions to find out what it was we bought. Who are these folks up here? Lewis and Clark. Meriwether. Is it Meriwether? I can't remember. Lewis and Clark and Sacagawea. I can never say that. Sacagawea and a baby. By the way, I said some students years ago who wanted a bonus question. Can I have a bonus question on the test? I said, find out the name of the baby. And I think it's on the test still. So if you want to go Googling, what was the baby? What's such? It turns out it's a Frenchman's baby. She's Dakota, one of the Dakota tribes. She's got another baby of another. She's kind of a modern woman with various baby daddies. They leave out of St. Louis, Missouri. They get on the Missouri River and they follow it up to the Dakotas. She serves as their translator as they come up to various different groups. And they find something fantastic. And it's over there on that big map over there. I'm pretty sure they see the Grand Tetons of Wyoming, right? Wyoming, southern Montana, Wyoming. Spectacular. I used to have a picture, but I guess I don't have a picture on there now. Spectacular Rocky Mountains that they find. The other guy, by the way, they make it all the way up to what we would call Oregon. And then another guy named Zebediah Pike, he goes in to the front range of the Rocky Mountains, and he goes all the way up to something called Pike's Peak, which I believe is about 12,000 feet high. I can't imagine making these expeditions that they made. And what they mostly say is, beautiful territory, we don't know what we're going to do with it. There's some massive mountains out there in the west. And if you look at that map over there, you can see what happens the further you go west, the color changes from green to yellow and then to brown. What do you suppose those green color changes signify? What is it?
Elevation?
The topographical nature of these things handle the elevation. I can tell you that I live in Abilene, Texas, and I can tell you that the difference between Waco, Texas and Abilene, Texas was rainfall. And so the further you get out west, the less rainfall and the more arid it becomes. Now, there's hardly any forests in here, trees and such, only along the rivers. But otherwise, in fact, they call it the Great Plains. I mean, they just see a bunch of grass out there. It's pretty grass, but they're not sure that it can be used for farming. They kind of got bad news for the president. They're like, I'm not so sure. We did get Louisiana, and that'll be helpful. Probably Arkansas and Missouri. You know, these will all be helpful, you know, plentiful. Let's see. Yeah, we're going to get Arkansas out of this and Missouri. And would that be Iowa and Minnesota? Yeah, so there's some pretty good spots along there. But then the further west you get, they're not so sure we'd ever make use of it. Now, there is one place that they find. Look at this over here in the top left-hand corner. Look what has happened to the color again. It's become green. That is one of the most lush places, right? That's the valley in Oregon, and it gets a tremendous amount of rainfall, right? And it's pretty temperate for as far up north it is because of the way and I don't know if you want to look at that map behind Josh there, but that takes us up into Canada. Actually, all this area up here is surprisingly temperate, and you can grow things there. Later on, we'll want the rest of it, but we won't get it. All right, so that leads crazy Americans to go out there and try to get Oregon, right? Isn't it the craziest thing in the world that Americans would travel 2,000 miles on foot Walking along wagons. Do you ever play that game, Oregon Trail, when you're like 8th grade, you know? I've heard of this game. I never played it. Evidently, there's some computer game that you could play in junior high. But thousands and thousands of Americans, with plenty of land here in the east, I think, that people could have continued to work on, but maybe it was held by large property owners. But they made out that trek out to Oregon. Other Americans entered into the territory as fur trade was a big thing. And so single men mostly would go out, interact with the Native Americans. They'd go all the way out to the Rocky Mountains and interact and get pelts, trade it, fur. Native Americans would meet them at what things called rendezvous, and they would bring furs east, and they'd bring finished products west to the Native Americans who were non-metallurgical. And so we kind of have not using it a lot. We won't really use that territory much. And we will this eastern part, but this western part we won't even hardly touch until after the Civil War. So the Essex Junto is an interesting development. The Essex Junto. I have no visuals for it. Sorry. A junto is a group of conspirators. It's a Spanish name. I guess that's what the Spanish call a group of conspirators who plan to seize power. We could switch to the French word coup, which means coup d'etat. Have you heard of a coup d'etat? It looks like this. That state or government. So a strike at the state is what a coup d'etat is. Recently, we've pretty much just dropped it down to a coup, in case you're wondering about that. But a junto, Spanish word for a group of conspirators. I don't know why we call it a junto since we're here. But Essex, I believe it's Essex. I always can't remember if it's Massachusetts or if it's, it's not likely Vermont. I guess it could be Connecticut. But up here in New England, in the town of Essex, and I think there's a couple of Essexes in different states, a group of conspirators get together and start talking about something. And what they're talking about is this country is much too big to be managed by one government. There's no way that all these people here, all these people out here, the South, the North, there's no way that this can all stay under one national government. It's just too far flung. It's going to be too many different interests. And since that's likely not to stay together, why don't we precipitate this action in this area? So it's a group of conspirators who imagine going out to the West, working with Westerners who've moved out there, and declaring their independence from the United States and creating a new government, a new nation, a new confederation of states. Who would probably live at peace with the rest of the country, but among the group of conspirators is a man named Aaron Burr. Who's on your ID list? He's in that group of first generation leaders. Do you remember Aaron Burr, what we've talked about him so far? A political powerhouse out of New York. Yes, right. In the Electoral College in the 1800 election, his supporters were supposed to throw their vote behind Jefferson. But at the last moment, they started thinking, we may have the votes to make him president. And so he was not to be trusted. I think he managed, he becomes vice president in that first term, but then Jefferson doesn't keep him for the second term that he's in. He goes back to New York politics. And I think y'all may remember this. Do you remember that Hamilton basically had the decision in the House of Representatives because the Federalists wouldn't listen to him? And he said, hold your nose and vote for Jefferson because Aaron Burr can't be trusted with power. I guess it's after 4 years that Aaron Burr goes back to New York and he's now running for governor of New York. Alexander Hamilton's also from New York. Alexander Hamilton again moves to make sure that Hamilton does not get the governorship. He says this man is unstable, unprincipled, and we cannot trust him with power. Aaron Burr again loses, and he blames Hamilton for this. And so he decides to call Hamilton out for a duel for having personally disparaged him. Dueling was becoming illegal in most states. And I'm pretty sure it was already illegal in New York. But it was out there. Burr had challenged Hamilton. Hamilton's friend said, "Don't go. He'll probably actually shoot you." Oftentimes, men would just go out, and once they got there, things had cooled off, and they would often shoot out into the forest or whatever, rather than... But it was maybe just enough to have gone through a couple of sleepless nights and to steel yourself enough to show up to the honor ground, or the field of honor, I think they called it. Hamilton evidently had probably plans to run for president someday, and he feared, evidently, that he would be charged with, if you're not man enough to stand up for your own personal honor, how can you be trusted with standing up for the honor of the country as president? Wouldn't that make a pretty good, you know, point against him? That's what he worried about. And so he goes out to do. And they get out there on the ground. And I think Hamilton fires his gun into the forest, but I'm not sure. What is that? Is it in the air he shoots it into? Lisa, did you see the Broadway show?
Yeah.
I wanted to see it last week, but I couldn't pull it off. It's too expensive. $400 tickets. And Burr shoots him in the upper torso and mortally wounds him, and he dies 2 days later, or within a short amount of time. And that's how the man who was all over the place, Alexander Hamilton, who'd served as Washington's aide-de-camp during the Revolutionary War, who really shaped the course of the early national government with the creation of the bank, with the taking on the debt of the various different states, the whole concept of the Constitution, the Annapolis Conference, all those things, the Federalist Papers, his name is all over and shaping the country, and as he falls off the stage, so to speak, as we've been talking. And that's why he's all of a sudden gone. There's a man named George Will, who's a political commentator, who is not as active as he used to be, but he had something to say about Hamilton that I thought was pretty cool. He had some people visiting him in Washington, and they said, "Well, where's Hamilton's monument?" And he said, "Washington is Hamilton's monument." D.C., the concept of this national government and what the country became, that is a monument to Hamilton. And he's one of only a few presidents who are on, non-presidents, who are on our currency, right? Anybody know what currency he's on? Maybe. By the way, I think we need to get this down, because you might have a foreign exchange student, you know, living with you someday. They might go, "Who's this?" And you're like, "You ought to know who's on the money, right?" So $1 bill. $2 bill, they exist. There's a $200 bill. And if you go to Charlottesville, what's the name of the place? Monticello?
No,
who's on the $2 bill?
Monticello. Jefferson.
$5 bill? Lincoln. $10 bill? $5 bill? $10 bill?
Hamilton.
Hamilton is Hamilton. Hamilton's on the $10 bill. $20 bill? Andrew Jackson, maybe not forever. There's a movement afoot to try to get him off of it because of his sorry record with regard to slavery and the Indian Removal Act, or ethnic cleansing, if you want to call it that. $50 bill. Ulysses S. Grant. And then the one you always hope to see at Christmas or birthdays when you open up that envelope. Ben Franklin's on the $100 bill. So what, two of them weren't presidents. Which ones are those being? It'd be Well, no, who weren't presidents. Only two aren't presidents. So that would be Hamilton and Big Ben. But Benjamin Franklin, they credit him with so much of the early part of the country, too. All right. So the reason I'm... Okay, so now to come back to the Essex Hymn. After the duel and after the killing of Hamilton, friends of Hamilton in New York who are in government service serve out a warrant for the arrest of Hamilton on the grounds of, I don't know if it's murder or manslaughter, probably manslaughter, because it's illegal to duel. And so Aaron Burr goes on the run, and he goes out west with some of the conspirators. And now that his day is done in national politics in the East, he wants to go out west where he will lead a group in breaking off from the rest of the United States. But it kind of tells you how vulnerable the country is during this early period, that people would even think along the lines of leaving like that and maybe breaking off a part of the country, that this thing wasn't going to stick together. Too many problems, too big, too many differences. He's eventually found with an armed group of men floating along the Mississippi River. There, I think federal agents are after him at this point in time. They arrest him, bring him to Washington, D.C., where he stands trial for treason. And I keep meaning to follow it up. I do not know why, but he is let off. I guess it's Marshall that makes the final decision on that. I could look it up. It would be Marshall, wouldn't it? If you're ever curious about something in any of this history we've been reading, besides your own books, if you want further, I highly recommend These Great Danes. Go to our homepage. Go to the library. You don't actually have to even walk over there. Once you get to the library, go to Academic Databases. Now, when you're off campus, you just put your credentials in. Come down here to something called American National Biography online. It says sign in, but you're already signed in at this point in time because you put your credentials in back at the library. Then you can go up here and search, well, Aaron Burr, for instance. Am I spelling that right? Is it two A's? Yes. Burr, Aaron. Let's see what happens down here. So anyway, this is going to be written by a historian who specializes in this period. Here's the name of the person who wrote it. It won't be too long, but it'll be very authoritative. It's a great way to find out a good amount of information on factual, trustworthy information on someone. It'll beat Wikipedia any day. And then at the bottom, it'll tell you where his papers are. How can you get into the original primary documents? So it says most of Burr's manuscripts are in the New York Historical Society. I was just there. Additional correspondence is in the Yale University Library, Library of Congress. See also political correspondence and public papers of Aaron Burr. So somebody took the time to actually publish a whole bunch of his letters. Then it looks like memoirs. Then it talks about secondary sources. The best biography is Milton Aaron Burr, two volumes, 1979, 1982. So, that's a great, if you were doing a research paper or something, this would be the great place to go and find out what are the authoritative works on somebody. Let's see what happens here. Let's read it. Returning to Washington, in April 1805, Burr traveled to the west and down the Mississippi River to New Orleans. Despite a warm welcome from a number of leaders, Burr was disappointed that there did not appear to be an immediate prospect of a clash between the U.S. and Spanish troops on the Louisiana-Texas frontier. Didn't know, but that must be up there. Without this fighting and a subsequent American invasion of Mexican territory, Burr did not believe he could implement his plan to break off part of the country. Return to Washington, Burr did not gain British interest in his plan, but the Spanish government did provide him with $10,000 ostensibly to defend Spanish America against U.S. filibustering expeditions. 60 followers and half a dozen flatboats on the Mississippi River.
Instead, he informed President Jefferson of a deep, dark, wicked, and widespread conspiracy and ordered the arrest of Burr and his followers when they reached the lower Mississippi for allegedly seeking the secession of Louisiana Territory. After being paroled, Burr attempted to flee to Spanish territory, but was again captured and sent to Virginia. In 1807, he was indicted for treason and brought to trial in the U.S. Circuit Court in Richmond, Virginia, with Chief Justice John Marshall as presiding judge. Personal and political conflict between Jefferson and Marshall carried over into the trial. Regarding the law of treason, Marshall gave a very restricting interpretation of the meaning of the Constitution words, levying war. Under Marshall's interpretation, Burr's absentee connection with a gathering of Burr's followers at this island was insufficient to make him guilty of treason. Despite Jefferson's strenuous efforts to obtain a conviction, Marshall's definition of the law resulted in Burr's acquittal. By the way, he married twice to wealthy women and he ruined both of them and took their money, left them destitute. Pretty despicable person. But so anyway, here's our American National Biography. Great place to go for any things in here. You can also do things like War of 1812. And in this case, it's going to bring you to something called the Oxford Companion to the United States History, which Oxford, well, this group about Oxford University has purchased this. So you can, these are things associated with the War of 1812. Here's the full article on it. So I'll be talking about War of 1812 here tonight. But so a nice overview of the war. Everything that's highlighted, of course, is further in hyperlinked for more information. But that's a great way to get more information on any of this that we're presenting in, or talking about in class. All right. We're now going to be moving to that War of 1812, sliding that direction. Jefferson did some other interesting things as president. He was a collector of various flora and fauna, and I think he arranged for some studies. Do you know about that, Charlie? Doug?
I know he was very interested in the botanical and agricultural fields.
Didn't he have a tremendous collection of specimens?
And fossils and mammals and birds and he plants. Said, he had a great garden.
Did he give all that to
vast samples back to Jefferson to send them back during the trip?
Oh, I see. Yeah, did some of that go to the Smithsonian, come to the basis of the Smithsonian collection?
Well, up there, he even had live
animals shipped back. Elk and things like, well, elk they would have had out here.
Two grizzly bear cubs they shipped back to him. They kept in the White House in a pit. And then
I never heard that.
I don't know what happened to them. They got too big, and I guess they killed them. a lot of things like that.
Wow. Should have sent them to England. A gift for the prime minister. All right, so let me tell you, I think, do I have a picture of it? I do not. Thomas Jefferson's is buried on the grounds of his estate, which is called Monticello. Something he designed is on the back of the nickel, if you wanna see what it looks like. Funny story about, he was always working on that place, always wanting to improve it. There's stories about some visitors who came there one time and he was walking around in a house coat and everything was in disarray and there was just things everywhere, but he seemed to be perfectly at ease because he could see the future about things. He invented different things at his home in Monticello. Is he wrote so many letters and he wanted copies of them. He came up with a device so that when he wrote here and the contraption wrote on a second piece of paper, the first copy, copier, I suppose you could say. But on his tombstone, it says, here lies Thomas Jefferson, author of the Declaration of Independence, author of the Virginia Statute on Religious Freedom, or Freedom from Religion, founder of the University of Virginia. And that's all he puts on there. What does he leave off? President of the United States. He didn't put that one on there.
And I think it's because he felt the mistakes of the latter part of his presidency left him afterwards wondering whether or not he was actually a good president or not. And what really confounded him as president, and all presidents make mistakes, he makes a pretty big one, but it is pretty tough to figure out how to negotiate this problem. And the problem is this: war in Europe between Napoleonic France and his and Napoleon's possessions of most of Europe, along with, I've got a, I think I can pull it up for you pretty quickly, what the situation is over in Europe, and then I'll come back to this. Anybody see the French Revolution on here? I'm going to go back a ways. Oh, there it is. This map shows it best. After a variety of battles, Napoleon defeats the Prussians, lots of Germanic smaller kings and princes, the Austrians, and even the Russians. And he annexes all this area, makes this thing called the Confederation of the Rhineland, takes over most of Italy and puts his family members over it, has got Spain largely annexed. And then, but he can't get England to agree to accepting the French domination of Europe, of Central Europe, Western Europe especially. Since England will not allow, will not accede to his domination, he is going to try to use economic pressure on them. He says that none of these territories will import anything from England. And he also gets the Russians and the Austrians and the Prussians to agree to it. It's called the continental system, is what he calls it, that we will not trade, no one will trade with England. Now, England retaliates and says, fine then, nothing will be traded into France. And this puts American vessels in trouble, because between the French trying to stop trade with England and the English trying to stop Americans from bringing sugar and tobacco and various other products into Europe, we get into real trouble. But the bigger culprit seems to be the British. They are the bigger problem. Couple things here that I might mention. The British and the French fought a huge battle in about 1808 called the Battle of Trafalgar, which involved over 100 naval ships. The British won that battle, but they lost a terrific number of ships and something like 20,000 sailors. And the deal with England, this issue called impressments, nobody joined, other than the officers, who were aristocratic men mostly, who ran the Royal Navy. The average seaman were pressed into service. Nobody wanted to join the British Navy. It was known as a floating hell. They used corporal punishment, floggings and such. You're gone for years at a time. And what they would do is they had what were called press gangs. They would have older sailors, men, probably some junior officers, who when they were in a port town in England would be given some money for this purpose. They would go to taverns and look for independent young men who probably came in from the countryside and was looking for work, buy them drinks, say, hey, there's a brothel down the street, we'd love to take you down there, you'll enjoy yourself, you deserve it, young man. Get him good and drunk, maybe a couple of them, and then the next day that kid wakes up on a British ship, and when he wants to leave, he actually they come in and they're like, congratulations, you joined the British Navy. He's like, I what? Like, yeah, last night you swore an oath to be part of the British Navy. You're now one of His Majesty's servants until we release you. And that was it. You're now, if you try to jump ship, as it was called, or try to get away. It was it. That's you got pressed into service. That meant that English sailors, when they got a chance, they would jump ship, literally. If you were in a port, let's say you're in a British ship and you're in North Africa at, say, Monaco or something, if you saw an American ship in the harbor, you would try to get on that ship and you'd say, listen, I'll work for free for you guys if you'll help me get the heck out of here when you leave. And so a lot of British sailors would try to get on American ships where they would maybe have to go to Boston first, but eventually could work their way back to freedom in England. So here's what begins to happen. During this standoff between France and England, British ships, also after the Battle of Trafalgar, when they lost like 20,000 men too, they start regularly stopping American commercial ships on the high seas. Stop them, and they go along, they get the crew out, and they go along and they say, you're escaped. They just start taking people. Some of them may have been sailors from Britain, legitimately having escaped, but a great number of them were American citizens who now find themselves pressed into British service, and their families at home are very upset about this. Jefferson is complaining through diplomatic channels with the British about this policy and telling them to stop it. And the British don't care. And they don't worry about us. What are we going to do? So the most egregious thing that happens, and it's your next ID, it's called a leopard. Do I have the Chesapeake spelled correctly? I guess I do. I must have fixed it. There for a long time it was wrong. Oh, there it is. Here buried. I knew I had it somewhere. Declaration of American Independence, Statue of Virginia for Religious Freedom, Father, University of Virginia. All right. The leopard, your ID, is a British ship of war, pretty big one, that is cruising off the coast of America near Baltimore, just off our waters. I think it's 8 miles out to sea that becomes international waters. Once you get 8 miles off of the coast anywhere, it's international waters. But they're right off our coast. And they see a ship, an American ship, called the Chesapeake. And the larger British leopard sends a signal through flags telling the Chesapeake to stop and prepare to be boarded. It just so happens the Chesapeake is an American naval vessel. So not a commercial vessel, not a private ship owned by American citizens, but a ship of the United States Navy. Obviously, the officer does not agree to this. This is an affront to American national pride and rights as a sovereign nation. So the Leopard opens up fire on the Chesapeake, killing a number of American sailors. The American Chesapeake finally comes to, lowers its sails, stops, it gets boarded. The British take off with a number of American sailors who they claim are escaped British sailors. I don't know if any of them were or not. And then the Chesapeake limps back into Baltimore Harbor, all beat up, blown up, you know, it's devastating. Pretty well beat up, and it's got dead American sailors on it. And the city of Baltimore is up in an outrage because they're already upset. I mean, all of our American port cities are losing ships to this sort of, well, ship sailors. So it hits the national newspapers, and this country's in an uproar. And it is the job of the President of the United States to deal with this, right? And this is where Jefferson does not think through things enough. He decides that the way he's going to deal with this English is to use economic pressure on them. He gets something called an embargo act. I don't think I have kept it on as an ID for you, but an embargo is a refusal to trade with a country. He says that no
trade will take place between America and England. And Congress passes it. By the way, this is going to become one of the policies taken by the party in power that greatly upsets the party out of power. Why would an embargo with England be upsetting to the Federalists? And they're going to decry this. Money, exactly. The cities of Portsmouth and New York and Boston and Providence, all up the seacoast, are dependent on trade with England. That's how they make a living, is taking things over there. An embargo is going to bankrupt them. So what do Americans do when they think there's an unjust law? They think it's perfectly legal for them to do something before they can get it on a ballot? Ignore it. So now Jefferson's in the horrible position of having to enforce this embargo by having the U.S. Navy not out fighting British ships to make up for the affront of their policies. Instead, he's having to arrest American ships and throw people in federal prison or federal, bring them before the law and say, you're breaking the federal law here in trading. This really is problematic, and the Federalists are up in arms about this. Before he finishes out his second term, Congress, even his own party, moves to end the embargo. They realize that it's a mistake, and he's like, yeah, go ahead. So he does not know how to deal with this problem, and it does not go well for us. And he looks pretty weak in it. And it further escalates the tensions within the country, highlighting the differences between the New England states and the rest of the country. He leaves office feeling pretty dejected over this, and he does what Washington did. He steps down after two terms, and he has basically handpicked his successor, his Secretary of State. The Secretary of State is probably the most powerful of the executive cabinet members. They're involved in more than just affairs with other countries. They have to do with the functioning back then of the whole apparatus of the government. But it's a pretty cool way of doing it. I kind of liked it, and I kind of wish we still use this today. If it could have worked, you'll remember that the Romans had the problem of how do you get a good next person, and they especially had this problem under the empire. You might have a good Caesar Augustus. You might also have the good ones like Marcus Aurelius, but how do you get the next one? If they go with hereditary rule, it's horrible. But what could happen, this looks like the old Roman system of something called the cursus honorum, the honorable course to power. You would hold public offices, and the last one that you would hold in Rome before becoming a consul was something called proconsul, and where you got all this government experience before you stepped in and took the reins of power. And this looks like what we were doing. We have a number of presidents who pick a Secretary of State who then elevates to the presidency. And that's what happens with James Madison, who you also know. So you've got him on your ID list here. So you've got him as, this is the first time we've heard of James Madison. We know him mostly as, he's considered to be the father of the Constitution, as I like to say, the word father. He's the one who came up with the Virginia Plan, the checks and balances, and separation of powers. Then he served as Secretary of State. He was important as someone with regard to the Federalist Papers. And now, finally, he takes the presidency.
Do you have an extra of those papers?
What is that?
Do you have an extra of the other paper with the names on it?
I have this one. Do I have more? World War II. World War I. Not with me. Do you see our ID? We've now jumped down to Leopard. I've kind of go back and forth between people and events. And y'all, gentlemen, y'all have an ID list now? I think you didn't have one. All right. The problem continues with England all through the presidency of James Madison, his first term. And there's a growing animosity in America. There is going to be a growing drumbeat for war. And this is where I want to get for you guys the ID Warhawks. I'm going to go ahead and close this blind because I think it's getting too much. At least this one. I guess this one. You can leave the other one. I want to talk about the Warhawks. I want to talk about Tecumseh and Tippecanoe as well. And this all has to do with the Indian problem. And the problem is that they exist. And they occupy their land. And we want their land. And that's the problem. So we've had, now that we own the Mississippi River and New Orleans, there's been a massive movement of Americans into the the other side of the Appalachian Mountains. Where they are coming into contact with Shawnee tribes. And some of the Shawnee tribes, again, by the way, they're not together in any kind. They speak the same language, but they have friction with each other. There's a massive amount of territory out there. Their population is not very dense compared to the land. And they're having a hard time resisting the American encroachment upon their territory. And I guess this brings in there's several IDs here. William Harrison is an ID for you. He's in here. William Harrison reminds me of a young George Washington. He's born in Virginia to the Washingtonian property class. He has gone out to Ohio and into Indiana, where he is pushing the frontier. He becomes the natural leader of the American colonists who've come out there. I think that it's Jefferson who names him as governor of the Illinois Indiana Territory. The Shawnee are trying to resist the encroachment of Americans. The British are hearing talk that the Americans are beginning to think, well, we might not be able to attack England for what they're doing to us because of their strong navy. We can't attack England, right? Can't float over there or sail over there and attack England. But we could possibly attack Canada and maybe even seize Canada. So the British take over the role that the French had played with the Native Americans, which is kind of ironic since it was the British who were fighting against the Native Americans in the West when they still had the colonies. They now become very close to the Shawnee tribes because there may be a war involving the Americans, and the Native Americans would be a good ally for the British. And so the British begin to give them weapons so they can defend their territory against American encroachment. Tecumseh, ID for you. I may have a picture of him on here. I don't. Tecumseh and his brother Tenskwatawa, maybe. No, probably Tenskwatawa. These two are Shawnee. Tenskwatawa is what we would call, I think today, a medicine man. He was the religious leader. His brother Tecumseh is a Shawnee chieftain, and Tecumseh begins to try to get all Shawnee to combine into a confederation. And because they realize if they don't join up together and defend themselves against American encroachment, there's no end to this encroachment. A pretty big battle, this one called the Battle of Fallen Timbers, was between Shawnee and American settlers. William Harrison leads that one. I think that one's largely inconclusive, although I do think the Shawnee back up some. But then there's the battle called Tippecanoe, which is a river or small river up in Indiana on November 1811. And in this encounter, Tecumseh's gone. I don't think Harrison's even there. But American soldiers fall upon Shawnee tribal members and eventually run off the tribe from the battlefield. And on the battlefield, they find cases of British weapons. And that is what we would today call the smoking gun. Clear evidence that the British are arming our enemies. So between the impressments of our sailors, the stopping of our ships, the event with the Chesapeake, and now arming the Native Americans, a growing call for war with England emerges. And that group is called the War Hawks. They're beating the drums of war in the press. They're giving speeches as senators or congressmen. They are writing editorials in newspapers. Newspapers aligned with them are calling for war. They tend to be Westerners, like William Harrison, a guy named Henry Clay in Kentucky, but also Southerners, like John Calhoun. The young John Calhoun at this point in time is also advocating for war. And here's what I want you to know. Although it's a war with England, the bigger prize is Native American land, Native Americans' presence east of the Mississippi River. A war with England is going to open up a free-for-all against all Native Americans. And if you'll look at this map again for me, this territory down here, Alabama, Mississippi, which we have claimed and are beginning to move into, Muscogee, Cherokee, Creek, Seminole, I think of the last group. Choctaw, big one. They live here. Up here, it's the Shawnee, Blackfoot, I think. Can't remember the other groups here. I have another map that could show us all these names. A war with England and their allies here in North America means we would carry out a campaign against them, and then we would take all their land. Now, the word hawk. A new word enters into our lexicon. And if you, it's in politics, if you're someone who favors war, you're called a hawk. If you're someone who favors being more circumspect and trying to find a peaceful solution, you become known as a what? You want to guess? A dove. So Bernie Sanders, dove. Mike Pelop. The new Secretary of State, probably more of a hawk. A funny thing is there was a bar in Washington, D.C. forever, right by the Capitol, and it was called the Hawk and the Dove. They didn't care if you were a hawk or a dove. If in between votes, you can come over and have a beverage, you can. So I just kind of wanted you to know that comes into, so you hear someone being hawkish or being dovish. Hillary Clinton was thought to be a bit hawkish. She was in favor of it. She was no dove. All right. So, James Madison gives an ultimatum to the British to stop arming the Native Americans, to cease their orders of council, which give them the right to stop our ships. The British do not reply in time, and so now James Madison writes a letter to the House of Representatives, to Congress, in which he lays out the different things that the British have been doing. And then he says Congress may consider what to do next. So he kind of rides the fence there. He knows there's a lot of call for war, but I don't think he himself wants to be the one to say, let's go to war and actually ask for a declaration of war. He simply puts it in the hands of Congress. Now, it sails through where? He gets a vote for it, I think, in the Senate.
but I can't quite be certain of that. But where there's more Federalists, I think that maybe the, I'm not sure where that is, the vote's really close. The Federalist-dominated states say no. They think this war with England would be a bad idea. It would obviously further devastate. I mean, they've just got through the embargo. The embargo's over now, but going to war with England is not going to be a good thing for the Federalists. And they're not so sure about that further Western expansion anyway. But enough people vote for it that the declaration of war goes forward. The first year of the war goes horribly. We obviously can't go to war with England, but we go to war with Canada. We march up towards Montreal, and we march across this peninsula here, heading for I think a place called York, and we attack the Canadians. And when we can't hold York, we burn it on the way out. It was like the county provincial seat. We get defeated at every round. Some of us had thought that maybe the Canadians would want to join us, but evidently they did not. So the first year of the war goes horribly. The Americans' soldiers really aren't very compelled for it. I think we're better at defending our own property against encroachment rather than attacking other people to try to take theirs or defeat them. Our commanders weren't very good. The only success in the first year of the war happens down in Alabama at a place called Horseshoe Bend, which I should have added on, but it might make the, I think this does make the quiz at least. Horseshoe Bend. A man named Andrew Jackson from Tennessee, who had been, lots to say about Andrew Jackson. We'll watch some film on him later on. He was he's a Scots-Irish immigrant. Probably family came over in the 1750s, probably. He's born in about 1760-something. His dad dies at some point. They're very poor. They live in the western part of North Carolina, basically Tennessee, nearly, down in here somewhere. His mother dies during the war. His brother, I think, gets killed by the British or dies of the influenza during the war. He himself gets pressed into service by British officers. He doesn't like the British officers, who are rather rude and mean to him, perhaps. But after the war, during the Revolutionary War, he develops a hatred for the British, like it's very personal and will impact how he conducts himself going forward. After the war, he comes out to Tennessee. He has a rudimentary education. He is literate. He can read and write, but not much education. He applies to be, he wants to be a lawyer. And the way you become an attorney back then was you would read the law. It was almost like an apprenticeship. Somebody who already was a lawyer would let you come in and read their books. You would discuss the different matters. And then eventually you would sit for an examination, which we called the bar. And if you could pass examination and show that you understood the concepts of the law, then you could have a license to practice. I don't know what the bar was like when he was taking it in Tennessee back at the time, but he becomes an attorney. Eventually, he becomes a Tennessee Supreme Court judge. People who've looked over his decisions and his written decisions said they were fairly ungrammatical, but pretty much right on the thoughts and the jurisprudence ideas. He eventually serves as a congressman for Tennessee to Washington. Doesn't like that too much. And when the war breaks out, he asks for command of soldiers who would fight the Creek Native Americans, who were in an alliance, supposedly, with the British. And so men from Tennessee volunteer to go with him, and he leads an expedition down into Alabama. By the way, he's accompanied with Cherokee allies who are fighting alongside with him. And they go and they find at Horseshoe Bend was a large creek village. And it was basically built on a bend in the river as the river went around. I don't know what it would be like. This bend in the river was where the creek built a large village, because it would be basically protected on three sides, and they had a barricade here. Jackson tells him to surrender. They will not do it. He brings in a forward attack here, but Cherokee braves swim across the river and start a fire in the back of the village. Gets a lot of confusion, and the American soldiers and the Cherokee fighters take the barricade, and they pretty much kill everybody in the village. Largely seen as a massacre, but the only victory in the first year, and so he gets some pretty good press, and he's beginning to get known. Things kind of slow down as we go into 1814. We've been repelled in our attack against, William Harrison will be fighting up here, and he will defeat Tecumseh on the battlefield, and Tecumseh will die on the battlefield. And he will die wearing a British uniform, partial British uniform, and he was a brigadier general in the British. Tecumseh, full-on brigadier general for the British, dies on the battlefield against William Harrison and American regulars and irregular fighters, irregulars being volunteers. The success of the war is against the Native Americans. The success against Canada doesn't work out. And now we're just kind of at a stopping point. And then the British decide to bring the war to us. They had been cruising the Chesapeake Bay and periodically launching raids on wealthy plantations. Go take somebody's stuff. But now they land troops at on the best approach to Washington, D.C. Washington was a brand new, not very many buildings there, but had the White House, had the Congress, had Georgetown, had other buildings being built. And they march on Washington at Bladensburg, your next ID. And if you're ever up in Washington, you'll see Bladensburg exit. Bladensburg is where American troops face a British army that's marching towards Washington. And the Americans do horribly. They break and run. It goes down to something called the Bladensburg Races, as if they were trying to see who the fastest American soldiers were by how fast they could run. But then the problem was away from the battle, out trying to outrun each other. The British then march in unopposed into Washington, D.C. The president and his cabinet have left the city. James Madison's young, vivacious wife named Dolly Madison, before she was famous for making little cupcakes and things like that that we sell in Walmart. Do they still do Dolly Madison is that anything around here, Dolly Madison?
Used to be.
It was a national, kind of like Twinkies and things like that. But anyway, Dolly Madison, the name is for true woman, was the wife of James Madison. She is expecting her husband to come back and have dinner at the White House with his commander. She's got like this big meal ready for them when she gets news that she's to evacuate Washington because the troops have been defeated. And she's thinking her husband's coming back and these men are supposed to leave with her. And she refuses to leave until she gets certain things. She wants this portrait of George Washington. It's hanging in the thing. Some other things. And then luckily, a young man at the State Department, before he leaves Washington, he stuffs in the Declaration of Independence, the original Constitution, other state papers. And when he's seen doing this, he's criticized for having bad faith. But it was a good thing he did it, because the British then march into Washington, burn the Capitol building, go to the White House, enter it, have the meal that was prepared for the president and his cabinet, and then they burn the White House. Then they go for Baltimore. The New England cities were not very much involved in this war. You will remember that the Federalists did not vote for the war, and they're kind of sitting on the sidelines. Baltimore, however, was the most active of the port cities furthest north. During the war, we call them privateers. Ships would equip themselves with men who were ready to fight, and they'd go out of Baltimore and look for British ships to engage war in. And the British knew that Baltimore was a robust supporter of the war, unlike the other New England cities. And it appears that the British are now contemplating something. With Washington now burned, and if Baltimore falls, and with the grumbling of the Federalists, what might happen? Can you imagine? Maybe New England splits off of the United States and joins Canada and comes back to the British Empire. And there were a lot of Americans who were contemplating this very thing from New England. So the fight at Baltimore, Washington goes down as the single most important battle of the war. Bladensburg is where our troops ran. Washington gets burned, and now the British bring their flotilla up to Baltimore to try to take out the city. And this, you really want to know, this is called Fort McHenry. And Fort McHenry is a star-shaped fort, where is it, at the end of the peninsula in the Baltimore Harbor. You can go visit it today. And the British bring their troops, their ships up, and they stop about here because this pretty, you know, it's hard to take on a fort from ship. You know, you're worried about getting blown out. They have dropped off a land-based invasion that's going to invade from one side, and the British fleet is going to try to destroy Fort McHenry. Your ID for this, of all things, is Francis Scott Key. You're going to say, why is Francis Scott Key? Francis Scott Key is a Maryland lawyer, an attorney, who's been hired by a family. The father of the family has been seized by the British and pressed into service because he's a doctor. And the British are about to go into battle, and they need men who know how to saw off arms and cauterize, and they need a surgeon. And so they've been rounding up surgeons and pressing them into service. And so this upset family hires a Maryland lawyer, I think he's from Georgetown, to go and try to find this, get their father released, or the father of the family released. So Francis Scott Key actually travels up to where the flotilla is, and he is on a boat not far from where the action is, and the British start a bombardment of Fort McHenry, and they've got this new thing called a Couchetan rocket. It would basically be what we today might think of as mortars, where you could shoot them up in the air and, you know, pretty much hone in where they're going to fall at. They could go further than some of the cannons. And they rain down these rockets on the fort, thinking that that's their preparation. And they're hoping that the fort will surrender based on this barrage that's going to come at them. Having defeated American soldiers at Bladensburg very easily, they're thinking maybe Baltimore will be the same. But it's very different when you're defending your own city. And the people of Baltimore stand firm here. They've actually made this battle flag that on purpose, when they knew that the British were coming, they must have had some sense of this. They made an enormous flag, and they put it up over the fort with this attitude of come and get it if you can. And this is where Francis Scott Key comes in. Well, I guess there's some other thing I should mention too. The British armed forces that try to come over here, I guess this is the Battle of Newport. British stop marching here. Must be in here. At any rate, the British general gets shot out of his horse by an American, I don't know if it's a soldier or, anyway, American with a really good shot, a marksman, has climbed a tree and shoots a British general out of his horse, off his horse, dead.
Also, the American forces are putting up a very stiff fight here, and the British decide they can't take it, and so they withdraw. Furthermore, Fort McHenry, the morning after this bombardment, which lasted all night long, the dawn comes up, and that flag still above the fort, and the American soldiers are like, is that all you got? And Britain, the British admiral decides the city cannot be taken and leaves. Francis Scott Key decides to put this moment into a poem. Do you know what the name of this poem is? The Star-Spangled Banner. Oh, say, no, sorry. Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light? Oh, so proudly we, it's easier if you sing it. If you try to say it, it's harder. Well, so proudly we, what is it, anybody? Hey, hail? At the twilight's, the dawn's early light. It's about the,
we need a football
game. I know. It's the excitement that he felt in seeing that the defenders of Fort McHenry had stood their ground and that the British were fleeing. Now, after the war is over, this poem gets published everywhere, and then eventually it gets put to a British drinking song, a tune, and it becomes for us eventually the Star-Spangled Banner. It takes a while to get adopted.
Drinking song becomes our national anthem.
Yes. Well, it's, you know, a tavern song. God Save the King or something. Was a... Meanwhile, in December 1814, and these events were in June, I think, of 1814, two things happen. One, it's a Treaty of Ghent, but the other one is the Hartford Convention. Let me go to the Hartford Convention first. No, I guess I better go with the Treaty of Ghent first. The Americans have sent a delegation of envoys, if we could, to meet with the British to talk about peace. They meet in Ghent, Belgium, in December, and they talk about maybe ending this war. Napoleon has been defeated at the Battle of Nations. That war is over. So this whole issue with the need for impressments and the whole continental system and the embargoes and such, that's gone now, so the British can relax that. And basically, we agree to what is called the treaty is a status quo ante. Status quo being how things are or were. Ante, A-N-T-E, means how things were before. Let's just go back to how things were before. No one's lost. No one trades land. No one pays an indemnity, no one's really lost, no one's gained. Let's just go back to how things were before the fight. The only thing that we do agree is that the Great Lakes will be demilitarized permanently. We sign it, and now it's going to be some months before the ship makes it across the sea. About two, maybe 6 weeks to two months. In the meantime, two really important things happen. One of them is on January 5th, a group of Federalists get together in Hartford, Connecticut to have a conference about political grievances they feel. And as soon as I get done here, we'll get out of here for a break. So a group of Federalists get together at Hartford, Connecticut to discuss grievances they have in living in a country dominated by another political party. And they make a series of resolutions that they then send to Congress and the President of the United States. And here's what they say. They say, we demand, going forward in this country, if we have to make amendments, let's make amendments. These are, I guess, proposed amendments. No trade embargo can last more than 60 days, even if it ever gets passed again. Furthermore, the next one is this. 2/3 majority in Congress for any declaration of offensive war. Not necessarily if we get attacked by somebody else, that's natural, but it had been, I think, a simple majority to go to war.
And they want it to be, the war's a big deal here for them, and they want to not to get drawn into a war without two-thirds of the country agreeing to it. But look at that also for the admission of new states. It looks like the Federalists might want to be slowing up the admission of new states because they're most likely to be agrarians. Removal of the two-thirds compromise. That is that the states in the South that had been counting 60% of their slaves towards their representation in the House of Representatives, that goes away. So obviously the representation of the Southern states in the national House of Representatives would be greatly diminished. Future presidents can serve only one term. Furthermore, the successor must be from a different state than his predecessor, because we've now got something we're calling the Virginia Dynasty going on. We've had Washington, Jefferson, Madison. Looks like Madison, by the way, has picked up a guy named Monroe from Virginia also as his Secretary of State. He's probably going to be the next president. This is their grievances of living in a country in which they have become the minority party, and they're not. But here's the thing. They don't say it, but there is a, it's almost like that when a couple is having problems and one of the people in the relationship is really upset about the relationship, and they like send that text and they're like, well, lay out, or maybe it's a conversation, all these things here that are a problem with the relationship. What's the implication? If they're not satisfied, what? They're out of the relationship, right? This is like the prelude to a breakup. And they push send. Now, this meeting of the Federalists and this list of basically an ultimatum is going to be used to absolutely discredit the Federalist Party. In fact, we're going to call it the end of the first party system, because after this war is over, which is about to be, no one can ever say, vote for me, I'm a Federalist again, because the Federalist Party is going to be accused of being treasonous. It hardly even fought in the war. And then furthermore, it looks like it's ready to join our enemy and become part of England. The other really important thing that happens in January before the peace treaty arrives, letting us know the war is over, is the Battle of New Orleans. Again, involving Andrew Jackson. After his successful operation against the Creek people, Madison gives him the defense of New Orleans. So he goes down to New Orleans, where he's got to defend it, and it's a really weird city. It's a ragtag collection of Spanish, French, pirates, some escaped slaves who form a free black community in New Orleans. And he somehow, well, actually, here's what happens now. The British, after their, they had two things planned. After this battle here, they had sent an admiral to try to take New Orleans, and he'd been planning for this all during the early winter of 1814. And now he goes into operation in early January. I guess they thought that if they got New Orleans, it'd be a nice bargaining chip, I suppose, in a future negotiation, or maybe they'll get it. But so the commander has not been told that the war is over. So he launches his attack on New Orleans. New Orleans knows that it's coming. They want to sue for peace. The legislature there wants to sue for peace. Andrew Jackson puts people in jail and threatens to kill one of the Louisiana politicians if he doesn't stop talking like that. And he organizes the defense of New Orleans. And then, so the British have to leave their ships behind and march up to this series of redoubts and such that he's made. And the British make a really stupid frontal assault on this thing. And the Americans are behind a barricade. The British march right into it. I think the man who was supposed to give the command to either advance or gets killed. And for about 15 to 20 minutes,
No one tells them to withdraw, and they sit there and just get annihilated. I think like 5,000 British soldiers die right there, and no Americans die. And then the British leave. And this goes down as the great victory of the American soldiers in the only direct fight, really. I mean, Maryland had fought and defended itself. But this makes Andrew Jackson a national hero. And he's going to play that role out all the way to the presidency, ultimately. Later on, put to a song by Jimmy Horton, Battle of New Orleans. Reminds me of the history of, you know what music videos are? You ever seen a music video? You want to see one of the earliest music videos, I think? I think it's on the Ed Sullivan Show.
She comes from Spartanburg, South Carolina, but Johnny's going to dedicate this song to her. So let's have a wonderful hand for them, won't you?
I guess the British could have written a song called the Battle of Bladenburg and how the American troops ran. But this was a piece of patriotism of America as we made out to the Battle of New Orleans to be this great victory, after having otherwise not done so good in the war. So I guess you kind of burnish the victories that you get. Had you ever seen this?
Oh, many times. I've forgotten this. I read this in this book that only 13 Americans
with 13 Americans what?
13 Americans died.
Okay, they did. Okay, there were some deaths. I missed that. I thought there were none.
You don't really hear this song all night
now. Yeah, in your head. There you go. Well, I had to share, you know, little other history with you there. What is that?
Did their voices used to change like that constantly?
Voices change?
Yeah, he did like three different voices.
Yeah, I guess so. As an actress, you tuned into this, I think. He did some other famous songs. What if he? Did he do another kind of a national patriotic song, or was that the only one that's really along those lines? The funniest one I've seen is with Legos. It was great. Ever seen those like Lego video, and then like they like do little like claymation? But it's gone. This used to be there. All right. Well,
America just survived its most dangerous period, the first 25 years of the Republic. After 1815, we're going to call this a period the era of good feelings. That, in other words, we've gotten out of this period of real contentiousness because the Federalist Party's gone, and now every American calls themselves a Democrat Republican. And we finally have kind of gotten ourselves together. We weathered the storm. Of course, problems will reemerge, mostly over the question of slavery and expansion to the West, but there's that. I have to take a little detour from politics and look at some economic issues. America's about to change, right? Primarily, America was involved along the port cities in commerce and some manufacturing. And then as you get into the heartland, away from the cities, you get mostly agriculturalists, and then you get independent craftsmen like blacksmiths and such in towns. Most things that are made or manufactured in America are made by craftsmen, and we sometimes call them artisans. These pictures up here are a couple of artisans. Artisans tend to own, well, they own their own shop. They own their own tools. They set their own hours. They set their own prices. They decide how much they're going to work. Back in Europe, they'd been involved in guilds. We might have had some trade unions here. This is an early doggo type image, probably from the 1840s or 50s. He's a tinker. I guess in the trade of Paul Revere, he made, you know what those are? He'll tell us. We don't see them very much anymore. Teapots, really nice silver teapots. This guy's making tin cups, probably for people heading out on the Oregon Trail, right? They're gonna need a little water here. Now, how many teapots, silver teapots, do you think he can make in a month? That'd be kind of hard to do, wouldn't it? You think maybe six or so? I don't know. He would have to get enough money for those to pay for his family out of, let's say it was eight he made. Let's say that on a par for today, let's say you needed to make $4,000 a month to keep a family going, let's say. He was a single earner. Didn't that be about $500 for each one of those? Is that how much they cost now if you went over to Kohl's and looked for one of these for your grandparents' 75th wedding or 50th wedding anniversary? You might give them for them. They'd never use it, but it'd, you know, kind of be a sign of middle class standards to have one of these around. Why aren't they $500 now? They're made now by machines, right? So what I have here is that during this period of time, the late 1700s, early 1800s, we begin to have that phenomenon known as the Industrial Revolution, where machine-made products begin to replace manual labor and craftsmanship. It begins first in textiles, and then all during the 1800s, almost everything that's produced will get produced in factories. Factories will take the steps of production and break them down into multiple steps. And what they'll do is they'll bring in unskilled laborers who will do one part of the production process. And they'll I got a picture of the world we're headed to. These men are working in a shoe factory. 1820, you had gotten your shoes from a cobbler, and he would have made you a personal pair of shoes, right? And have all the tools for it and stuff, and they would be very expensive. These are going to be mass-produced, and we come up with sizes. Now, unlike the artisan over here, the tinker, where he owned his own tools, set his own hours, these guys own the tools they're working with? They do not. They are wage laborers. They trade their time for the labor. The raw materials, the factory, the tools, all that are owned by investors. And then this guy over here with the white lab coat-looking thing on, he's probably, the shop foreman, maybe? And his job is to get as much work out of these guys as possible, because he's answering quotas and such, and he's got standards set for him by management for what he's got to produce, because the board of directors and the investors want a certain return on profit. These guys don't look too happy, because they're going to stand there at one station and do one part of the production process all day long. It's called the division of labor. Now, it's much more efficient. It's going to reduce the cost of these products. And they're going to outproduce, they're going to be able to sell cheaper shoes than any cobbler could ever make. And that's the world that's coming. And we get the, and by the way, America will become one of the greatest industrial powers in the world. And so we're going to go through a transformation. Today, only about 3% of our population is involved in agricultural production, for instance. Whereas all during the early part of it, it was overwhelming percentage of our. So we want to ask the question, why? And so there's some important developments over in England. Around 1776, machines are beginning to be used. And they call them mills, because at first they're using water wheels and what used to be mills for grinding stone. But the very first mills get started over in England. And our New England, up in New England, we've got men who are going back and forth across the ocean. We're also reading about what's going on with them, because we've got the same language. So I guess one of the answers of why does America go down this road is because we're closely connected culturally and economically with the place that starts it all, and that's England. And people like Alexander Hamilton, when he gives that big report to Congress called Report on Manufacturing, he's thinking about what's going on in England, and he says we need to be pursuing that too. I think I've got the word limited liability on your ID. No, I've got general incorporation, I think, on your ID list. Let's leave down here somewhere. We've got a couple things. Where has general incorporation gone? Oh, it's over on that right-hand side. I probably deal with it elsewhere. But one of the most important things that England innovated with regard to business partnerships was to go away from just having joint stock companies where they allowed men to pool their resources for a big project, but it took a special charter from the king. But a lot of men didn't want to put their money in a joint stock company, because each one was liable for any liabilities or any losses or debt that joint stock company pursued. And the big innovation was to allow for something called limited liability corporations, where investors could put their money into this project, but if it went down, they just lost their investment. But in a joint stock company, if the manager of it, let's say you invested some money in this joint stock company, you're off in some other town, you put money on it. Well, it turns out that the manager of the company has run up the debt, borrowed money from these banks, and it went bad and then left town. That bank could get the list of the owners on the charter and go to any one of them and say, you owe me all this money. And you're like, wait a second, I'm one of 50 men. They're like, that's fine, you can go sue them for the money that they owe you of this, but you owe me the whole thing because you've got the money for it. That kept wealthy merchants from putting much money into it. But limited liability corporations really opened the pockets of the commercial class in England to be willing to put 5,000 pounds here and pounds there, because they knew what the downside of it was, and it was what they could lose. Now, another thing that's very important to our development is the adoption of this guy's theory on political economy. This is Adam Smith. He appears on your ID list. Where did I put him? Adam Smith. He's from Scotland, but we'll call him a British. Today we would call him an economist. At the time he called himself a moral philosopher. It's kind of a funny thing to think about with economics, but it was back in the time of the Enlightenment when we were beginning to explore what is today the social sciences. The name of his book, that's an abbreviation of it, but it's the whole title is An Inquiry into the Wealth of Nations. I think it's even longer than that. He wants to understand why are some nations becoming more wealthy? What policies are different governments using? Here's what you want to put down there. He rejects the theory of mercantilism. Mercantilism, we talked about it, I know, at the very beginning of the semester. It was the intervention of the government in the economy of France, of England, by the king, for the goal of getting more money for the king's treasury, granting monopolies, granting special charters. What Adam Smith says, if you want to create wealth, the government gets out of the economy. It gets out of the marketplace. We end up calling this thing laissez-faire liberalism. Today you think of liberalism as taking other people's money and giving it to somebody else. But liberalism as an idea means freedom from government, originally. So laissez-faire was this idea that the government is no longer going to mess with the marketplace. It comes from a French term. The guilds of Paris and other cities in France had prevented products being brought into the city to be sold. Like maybe a merchant might want to go to some small town and buy some shoes from a poor cobbler and bring them into Paris and sell them. But the guilds of Paris had arranged for it so that at every gate coming into Paris, the king's man would stop and look at a cart and say, oh, you can't bring that in here, these shoes to sell. Laissez-faire means let it pass. The government doesn't care what comes in the marketplace. You know what's going to determine what comes in the marketplace? Things that the consumers want. He begins to talk about an invisible hand, removing some people from the marketplace and putting other people in there. And he says that invisible hand is basically the efficiencies that will be required of people who compete with one another in the marketplace, because people will compete on price and quality. And if you allow free competition in the marketplace, you will encourage efficiency, better prices, innovation. And all prices, rather than being set by any group, should be a function of supply and demand. If there's a limited supply of something that's greatly in demand, price will be high for it, and conversely. The only real job, the role for the government is to provide infrastructure. Machines are capital intensive. They take a lot of money to buy a machine. And the first couple products coming out of that machine is really expensive. If you can only sell those products to a limited market because transportation costs are too high, there's no point in buying machines. So what he realizes is, if we have infrastructure, he wants to have canals in England connecting all the rivers and having the rivers dredged so that the price of transportation comes down, then that creates an environment where it makes sense to invest in machines because you're selling them at a great distance. We've got a company here in town called Colgate, right? They make over 1 million toothbrushes a month. Do we need 1 million toothbrushes in Morristown? No. It turns out that they pretty much supply from Canada to Costa Rica. All the toothbrushes, and about 1 million a month are sold all along the East Coast down there. Now, if you had to take those things by wagon, it wouldn't make sense, right? So the investment in machinery only makes sense if your transportation costs are low. And Adam Smith realizes that, so he says the legitimate role for the government in the economy is to create infrastructure. Number two, to regulate banks. Banks' credit is fundamental to the success of an economy. Bankers hold money. They ought to be regulated. We didn't have paper money that was issued by the government then. Banks issued money. They were called banknotes. And banks would take deposits and they would give you loans to people who wanted to borrow money from them. They'd give them banknotes that said, we promise to give the person who bears this piece of paper that we printed so much money upon, well, either this person or the person bearing it. That's paper money. Bankers realized that hardly anybody comes back to get the actual gold out of the bank. So they realized they could issue a lot of these banknotes, much more than what they had in reserves. And so Adam Smith knows that the shenanigans within banking need to be looked after by the government, and they have to go in, check, and see how many banknotes they've issued and how much they have kept in deposits. Insurance companies also. Education, he actually believes that we need more literacy in England. And that was about it. Maybe a navy to protect the shipping lanes. Well, why do I have this over here? I have this because laissez-faire liberalism, it's true that wealth is created. But the problem is that Europe is going through a demographic revolution. This is a graph of the population of Europe. This is just part of Europe. This is just Greece, Italy, and the Balkans. You can see that things are pretty steady. A pretty good amount of growth here in the high Middle Ages, and then it just falls off. What do you think that was? That was the Black Death. Then things got better, and then we start having improvements in agricultural production, new technologies, and all of a sudden, also inoculation against childhood diseases, and look what happens to the population. Goes from what, about 20 million up to 70 million? We're going to have, and England's going to be just like this. We're going to have England doesn't have the land to go along with this, right, to support all these people as farmers. And so what it leads to is an excess population who will be the wage earners in these new factories. But because it's based on supply and demand, there's a huge supply of people looking for work, and there's a low demand as far as number of jobs, and so wages fall through the floor, and families who can't make a living in the farming communities come into these mill towns. The wages are so low for the adult earners that it's bring your kid to work day, but not just like showing what you do, but like every day bring your kid to work day. And we get child labor becomes common. So part of the, I just mentioned that too, that that's going to be the problem side of it. But here's the next thing I'd like you to know. The Federalists, Alexander Hamilton, he knows what Adam Smith's doing. He knows what's going on in manufacturing over there, and he knows about this kind of attitude towards what the government can do to grow the economy, which is to do certain things like regulation of banks. That's why he wants his national bank to regulate banks in America. He wants a tariff to protect American manufacturing. And I'd like you to just put down this for Adam Smith. Adam Smith's ideas become the prevailing political economic policies of America all during the 1800s. And that we pursue a free market approach. And that's going to account for why we move into manufacturing. Because we're going to have a lot of pro-business policies that result. Now, a couple of ideas here for you. Sam Slater and Eli Whitney are both associated with machines. This is Samuel Slater. He's what we today call a mechanical engineer. He knows how to make these things. And these are the first looms. You load them up with yarn up there, you bring the yarn down to the machine. It's got these pulleys on it and such. And then once you get everything lined up and you start the power supply to it, it begins to create cloth. It's amazing, without anybody sitting there doing all the movements of the loom. He decides to come to America. He moves here and he brings know-how with him. The transfer of technological understanding is what he is representative of. He's not the only one who comes. Americans are reading about what's going on in England. Americans are traveling to England for business. And English businessmen and mechanical engineers are coming to America. And I'd like you to know that it's New England is where this is going to begin to get a foothold for industrialization. The merchant class out of New England, people like William Lowell, who's traveling back and forth to England, he decides he's going to take some of his capital and make the first factory. We'll talk about it here in a minute called Lowell Mills.
So we've got to be able to make the machines, and our own famous homegrown mechanical engineer, as we might call him, is Eli Whitney. We all know him more for something else, but he was a gunsmith, and what I want you to associate with him is the precise machining of his products. You hear about a machine shop that can do really good work as far as like getting something exactly right, these different calipers and things they use to. He was so precise with the guns he made. You can see Eli Whitney's improved firearms in New Haven, Connecticut. All the parts of his guns are exactly the same. Prior to this, a gunsmith would make a gun in his shop, and each gun was handmade, and he pretty much had models that he would work from, predominantly he. But what Eli Whitney sells the American government on is, if you buy my guns, I could take 10 guns, take them apart, scatter the parts, and then put it back together, and the parts could come from one gun to another, and they would all fire perfectly because they're so precisely machined. So if a hammer breaks, rather than trying to, and you're out in the West somewhere, rather than trying to find a gunsmith who can look at that gun and try to figure out where that hammer fell and try to make another hammer to replace it, he sells replacement parts. He gets his first big grant. But what I want you to think about with regard to him is, up here in Connecticut, they're beginning to get really good machinists who know how to work very precisely. And I don't know if you know it today, but America's still really good at making machines, but today it's automated things that we make. Automation is our thing. But it's the beginning, back in the early 1800s, of us learning how to make the machines, because machines are what are going to be key to the Industrial Revolution. He's mostly famous for this thing. What is this? The cotton gin. The British textile mills are using mostly wool. And there was the great age of wool production in the 1700s. You basically need tacky fibers and cotton. You can make it out of linen, some other products too. You can make, but cotton is really, have anybody felt a cotton head? It's real tacky. But what's it got inside of it? Seeds, right? You have to pick out all the seeds before you can spin it. And it turns out, I'll talk about it later on when I talk about the expansion of slavery. He comes up with a device, I guess it's kind of a cylinder with bristly brushes on it, that pull out the seeds and make cotton now a viable product for the mills of England, which is going to lead to the rapid expansion of cotton. And so it's no longer tobacco and rice that's going to be the major commodity of the South. It's going to be cotton. And cotton will become king in the South. And more money will be made in cotton than any other industry. And the wealthiest people in America, rival, even more so than some of the commercial traders in the Northeast, will be Southern planters. We'll talk about that later. Lowell Mills is the first factory in America. It's outside of Boston, some number of miles. They had to go outside of Boston to where there was falling water because they were going to use literally mills powered by water. And Mr. Lowell is a merchant who'd gone to England several times, and he gets together with some of the other investors, and they together build a building and put in it these looms. They get all the raw materials in, and they start making fabric to sell to the American people, because the Americans are buying most of their fabric from England, which is making textile fabric, bolts of fabric, at a much cheaper price than we can make it over here. I'd like you to know that Lowell Mills really gets its start during the time when we're at war with England, the Embargo Act, and then the war. That kept English textiles off
the American market, and it pushed the price of textiles up quite a bit. So Mr. Lowell and these Boston wealthy people decided, let's make a mill ourselves while prices are high. Well, after the war, England, now I guess we call it dumping, they start selling their excess inventory of textiles in America. They'd actually gone through, had an economic recession after the Napoleonic Wars, and now all of a sudden, the market over here is being flooded with cotton, with textiles, bolts of material. How do you think Americans feel about it when they see the price of fabric dropping dramatically? The average person. Isn't that great news? Wouldn't you go tell your neighbor, the price of, you know, this textiles, this calico is down to this. What about Lowell Mills? What are they thinking? They're in trouble, aren't they? They cannot make, for the price that textiles being sold now in America, they can't make it, and they're about to go bankrupt. They can't keep this up. So what do they need? They need protection from English imports. How can they get protection? Tariffs. And this is the beginning of one of the most controversial political economic policies in American history. The Federal Congress is the only entity that can determine import duties or tariffs. The states can't do it. This is coming out of Washington. And the friends of Lowell and the investors get legislation passed in Washington placing a tariff on imported textiles so that Lowell Mills doesn't run out of business. But what does that mean? American consumers are now paying this higher price for textiles. Does that make them happy? It is not. They're paying higher prices so that these wealthy men from Massachusetts who were stupid enough, they might say, to go and compete with the British business interests, and the British can make it more cheaply. Why should we Americans pay higher prices for textiles just so these guys can make more money? This becomes a fundamental difference between Americans, the American consumers versus producers. Furthermore, England retaliates. You throw a tariff on aluminum and steel? To quote recent trends, they're going to retaliate on bourbon and jeans and Harley Davidsons. Well, they're going to retaliate by putting a tariff on tobacco and a tariff on, they're buying some wheat from us and such. Do Lowell Mills care? Do the investors of Lowell Mills care if there's a tax on tobacco? Doesn't bother them. But what if you're the American producer? You're like, well, what the heck? I can't sell as much tobacco now because there's a big tariff over in England. The English people can't buy as much of it as they were because it's too expensive now. Or less people can. This becomes a fundamental aspect of American life, and that is a policy that favors one group comes at the expense of somebody else. Who's in the driver's seat is going to be the question. Well, the property people are going to try to be in the driver's seat, and they will get in the driver's seat pretty soon. And then the final one for this early period of the very start of our move towards industrialization is, it's actually the it's called the Claremont, but I couldn't find a picture of the Claremont. I found the picture of something called Walk in the Water, which is a hybrid. It's a half electricity and half, no, it's not half, sorry. It is a hybrid though. It's a schooner, it's got sails, but what else does it have? It has a steam engine that runs paddles that allows it to churn up river against the current. And if you look over here, so we've got these rivers. So especially up here in New England, you've got the Hudson River coming down the river. You've got all these people who moved up the Hudson River Valley, and they need products to buy. They would like to buy manufactured things. But the only way to get things up there to them was on horses, on trails along the river banks. This thing can be loaded up with all kinds of supplies, And it can churn its way up the river, stopping at different places, selling things much more cheaply than it had been done when it was just done on horses. So this is about this is about the expansion of the marketplace in America through water transportation. And the bigger the marketplace, the less transportation costs, the more it's going to make sense to invest in machinery because you got a bigger market to sell to. The next step is going to be canals. But that's dealt with later on. And then the next step after that will be railroads. And in the 1950s, it's the interstate highway system. But this infrastructure changes. And the growing size of the American population and the investment in a new way of making things based on what's going on in England is what puts us on the path of industrialization. But it's going to be cause policy issues, and it's going to split Americans into competing groups again. All right, there's that kind of the things that are happening during the time of George Washington through James Madison. All right, we'll return to the economic subject another time, but we're back now to politics and some other things that are threatening the unity of the American country. Now, I mentioned to you that this is called the Era of Good Feelings. It's after the war with England. This guy looks a lot like George Washington to me. His name is James Monroe. He's the last of the first five presidents from Virginia. It's this Virginia dynasty that the Federalists were all upset about. James Monroe also reminds me of George Washington because he kind of hears the complaints of the Federalists, and he picks for his Secretary of State John Quincy Adams, the son of John Adams. I don't know if you remember, but remember how George Washington kind of mixed up his cabinet? He put in Alexander Hamilton and Jefferson in the same cabinet. James Monroe does the same thing. Even though he's a Virginian planter, he has brought in New England people into his administration. In fact, he's even saying, fine, the next president will be a New Englander, a former. John Quincy Adams used to be a Federalist, but of course he said he's found Jesus and he's after the Hartford Convention, and he's now a Democratic Republican. Now, your next idea is called the Adams-Oney Treaty. If I'm pronouncing that right. I'm doing a French pronunciation, but I know it's going to be a Spanish name, but Onís, perhaps? Adams-Onís? Or Onís, I'm not sure. But this is a treaty between the United States and Spain. It's also called the Transcontinental Treaty. It goes back in that. This brings in somebody named Jackson. This has to do with the Gulf of Mexico, Florida, and the southern. Y'all see this territory right here? This was claimed by Spain early on, 1620, I'm sure. St. Augustine, Florida, Spanish. Northernmost province, but they also claim the entire coast here. We decide that we would like to buy it from Spain, and that's what this treaty is going to do. But I have to complicate it a little bit for you, because it portends some important political developments. One of the reasons we want it is because the shipment of farm commodities through New Orleans means that they basically goes through potentially hostile territory, right? There's Spanish squadrons down here. What have we got into war with Spain? This makes it kind of vulnerable still. But on top of that, we're having a problem with escaped slaves who, if they can make it to this territory, they can find their freedom. So southern planters don't like that. Furthermore, the groups that we have defeated in the War of 1812, like the Seminole and the Creek, they have taken refuge in this territory. Once they got run out of Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, and they would periodically make raids back into what had been their land and attack American settlements. In response to that, James Monroe asked Andrew Jackson to go down to the southern border here and attack any native tribes like Seminoles or Creek that come up from, I guess we call the Panhandle, that's going to be kind of hard, wouldn't it? I mean, where in the world would you do it? Andrew Jackson, let me go back to this. John Quincy Adams, as Secretary of State, it's his job to conduct the negotiation with Spain. And we approach the foreign minister of Spain, Adams does. We make an offer to buy this territory. And Spain says, not for sale. Andrew Jackson, down on the border, decides to do something aggressive, I suppose. Rather than staying on this side of the border and waiting for Native Americans to come across and then maybe go find them, he decides to enter into this Spanish territory, find Native American villages and defeat them there and say, don't ever come back across the border again or we'll burn more villages. Well, he invades this territory, not United States, with American soldiers. And in fact, in this one town, he comes across some British agents, businessmen, and he thinks they're arming the Native Americans, so he summarily executes them, which the British complained to the Spanish over, and the Spanish complained to Washington, D.C. over through John Quincy Adams. And they're like, what are you doing with this? What is this American general doing in our country? John Quincy Adams wants Monroe to recall Jackson from the field and to castigate him and tell him you weren't authorized to do that. One of the reasons that John Quincy Adams wants this to happen is because there's a lot of talk about this Tennessee and Jackson as being very popular, and probably because he's already shown an interest in politics, he probably has his eyes on the presidency. In fact, there's talking about a President Jackson. Well, why would John Quincy Adams care if Jackson had his eyes on the presidency? Because he's got his eyes on it too. So John Quincy Adams sees in this situation an opportunity, if Jackson is broken, as we might say, castigated and removed from the field, that would demote, that would undermine Jackson's standing in the country, right? Jackson counters and says, Mr. President, I've just shown Spain that we could march into Florida anytime we want it, and they might as well sell it to us while they can. And President Monroe says to John Quincy Adams, why don't you go back to the Spanish and offer them the money again and see if they'll take it? And you might mention the fact that we really could take this thing anytime we want, and a lot of Americans want to take it, and we may not be able to hold them back. People like Jackson and company want this thing. And so the Spanish decided they might as well get what money they could for it, and they sold the property to us. And now Jackson looks like a hero who has gained more things for America. Not to mention some lovely white beaches. Another important thing that happens under Monroe, and I don't have it here, is something called the Monroe Doctrine. In 1820, most of Latin America, imagine it's down here, goes up in rebellion against Spain, just like we rebelled against England for our independence from Granada, which is today Mexico, all the way down to Argentina, they go up in rebellion. The most important leader was a man named Simon Bolivar of Colombia. He's kind of the George Washington of Latin America. And they proclaim themselves to be independent nations, and they adopt a Republican democratic form of government. They translate the Federalist Papers into Spanish, and they model their new governments on the American model. They are our sister republics in the New World. And Mr. Monroe makes a declaration, which becomes known as the Monroe Doctrine. Spain, with the help of England, is thinking about restoring Spanish control over Latin and South America, with if the English help out, that would probably help the Spanish get it. Mr. Monroe says, let me warn you, Europe, that the Western Hemisphere is closed to any reconquest or any further colonial development. And it's basically a threat. It suggests that America will come to the aid of our sister republics should the European powers try to reconquer and extend their authority back over us. That we are the new world where things are very different and there's liberty here. And we're going to fight, we're going to be in solidarity with one another. Number two, he says, and oh, by the way, we'll stay out of European affairs. Y'all can, we'll be neutral for all the shenanigans that you guys have going on over there, but you guys stay out of the Western Hemisphere. Now, it kind of sets up America as the protective big brother in America, in the Americas. And in the 1820s and 30s, most of Latin America really applaud America for having taken this position. But by the end of the century, by the late 1800s, early 1900s, we seem to be the big brother that is kind of, well, I don't know, exerting our power over our sister republics. And appreciation for America begins to diminish as America begins to become assertive on the policies of our sister republics, probably coming to a climax when we take the area of Panama from Colombia under Teddy Roosevelt so we can make this canal. But that's a story for later time. Now, Missouri Compromise. For the first time since Philadelphia, one of the agreements in Philadelphia under the Great Compromise was that, I didn't mention this, was that the international slave trade, that Congress would not touch it for 20 years. There would be no legislation affecting the importation of slaves from Africa into America for 20 years. And that solved, that plus the Three-Fifths Compromise gets us through that thing. But now there's growing opposition to slavery emerging in America, especially up in New England. In 1820, Missouri, by the way, I don't think I've ever mentioned this yet. I know you've got to go. The process of admission, the process of new states, look how far we've gotten now. Now by 1820, here we are right for the 1780s, 1790s. Congress will lay out a territory and it becomes a territorial status. And then once people move there, after they get to enough population, they then write a constitution for themselves. And they send a delegation back to Washington where they present their credentials to Congress, and Congress accepts them into the Brotherhood of States. So Missouri applies for admission into the Union as a slave state in 1820. But look how far north it is. It's pretty far up into Illinois and Indiana and Ohio that don't allow it. When Missouri tries to come in, Congress says no, because these states up here are opposed to adding another slave state. And I'd like you to know that during this whole debate, which lasts for months, if not a year, the southern slaveholding states and the northern non-slaveholding states enter into a lot of acrimonious talking towards each other in the newspapers and editorials. We're beginning to get some friction between pro-slavery and non-slavery. It's like we got two sections here. And we're getting a little bit worried about what that means based on the rhetoric. Finally, now, by the way, you've got an amendment here. It's a Talmadge amendment. It should be on your ID list. A senator recommends a solution. Because here's what I want you, the people of Missouri who have moved here and brought slaves with them, they say it's not fair for us to have invested all this money in slaves and brought them to Missouri And now you're saying that, that our state can't have slavery. What do? We move, and this is our property. So Mr. Talmadge proposes this. He says, how about this? All the slaves you brought with you, they'll be your slaves throughout their life. But their children, when they reach 25 years old, they become free. So yes, you've argued that this is your property. You paid for these humans, which you consider your animals, basically. But their children become free at age 25. This seems pretty reasonable. But the southern states don't like it because it's a way by which slavery might come to an end. What if an amendment was passed someday that said, as of, you know, any person born in after 1840 whose parents were slaves, upon their 25th birthday, they are free. We would have slavery lasted into early 1900s, but then it would slowly come to an end. And that's not something that the southern states want to contemplate. So they say no to that amendment. That amendment does not go forward. Finally, the compromise is this. This northern part of New Hampshire, which is kind of a weird section up here, it kind of already existed. But Maine, the state of Maine, is created out of this kind of fuzzy territory up here. It's brought in as a non-slave state. And Missouri comes in as a slave state. And then you probably can't tell, but it makes an equilibrium, a balance of power. There, if you count them up, even though this looks like a lot bigger, if you count up all these non-slave holding states and all these pro-slavery states, they're equal. Therefore, in the Senate, there'll be an equal number of votes. Nobody has the advantage. But here's the compromise. So the two states come in, but they say this as part of the compromise. This is very important for the future, coming towards the Civil War. They say this line right here, the 36-30 parallel. Now, any future state that comes into the Union north of the 36-30 parallel cannot have slavery. This will be the last state north of the 36-30 parallel that will ever be admitted to the Union. Now, for New England, where there's a growing opposition on moral grounds to slavery, they kind of see that slavery is kind of on a course of final conclusion, because Mexico has all of this. Mexico has outlawed slavery. That means there's only a little bit of property left in the Louisiana Purchase that could even be states. Only what? Arkansas and this other thing, Oklahoma. But all this unorganized territory, as it's called, because it hasn't been organized into territorial states yet, any states up there will become not be slave states. And that's going to be where the big fight is in the 1850s. It's coming down the road. But that compromise buys us about 30 years, where slavery, which was dividing the country and polarizing the country and leading to politicians that were taking advantage of this polarization to be put on the back burner. And these states rapidly develop in population, half of which are going to be enslaved people. And then the last thing I want to mention, I could have mentioned him earlier, but John Marshall, I want to say a few last things about him and some important decisions that he made that were very important to America's development as a great place for business development and industrialization. And I think I want to talk about the Interstate Commerce Clause first. One of the reasons America becomes such a great economic powerhouse is because we are the world's largest free market economy. If you took this property right here and took it to Europe, you would have France, Belgium, German states, Italy, Italian states, France, and every time you crossed from nation, there were tariffs. But in the U.S. Constitution, contemplating this had to be Hamilton thinking about this, I'm sure. We take away the right of states to impose a tariff on goods and services coming from other states. It's called the Interstate Commerce Clause. It says only the federal Congress can regulate trade between the states. And it was very smart that they did that, because it's very understandable that people in, well, I'm going to give you an example. It's very understandable that if in New Jersey, well, let's say in Long Island, New York, let's say that dairy farmers up here are supplying milk to New York City, but right across the Hudson in New Jersey, dairy farmers are able to produce it more cheaply, and they're competing with farmers from New York. New York farmers might want to put a tariff, right, on New Jersey milk. It would be very natural for every state to have constituents that want to protect their market from products from other states. All right. Well, here's what I'd like you to know. John Marshall is going to make a very important decision in a case that speaks to the spirit of it, I should say. And I cannot remember the name of the case, and nor can I remember what two states it involved. But one state, let's say it's Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania is providing a lot of products into New Jersey. And the only way to get those products there was a barge across the river. You know, in a barge, it goes back and forth. They pull up the rope and then load it up. Well, the state of Pennsylvania, if I'm correct, thinks, if we had a bridge, we could move a lot more across there. So they start building a bridge across the river. And the other state says, well, you got to stop right in the middle of the river, because everything from the middle to our side is our state's, and we don't want that bridge. And the reason that state, let's say it was New Jersey, didn't want the bridge is because the producers of the products that the Pennsylvania people are selling in New Jersey don't want the competition from Pennsylvania. So they have passed legislation there in their Congress saying, you can't build that bridge over here. And so the state that wants to build the bridge takes it to the Supreme Court, and John Marshall says, okay, it's not a tariff, right? The Interstate Commerce Clause. But to say that one state can't build a bridge into the other state, that goes against the spirit of the Interstate Commerce Clause, and therefore that state can't stop that bridge from being built. And that becomes a really important thing for what America is, because there was definitely a natural interest in different states wanting to having constituents who, through the state legislature, could protect their state from other products. And the fact that we did not allow that to happen makes us the largest free market economy in the world. And it's going to allow us to invest in machinery, because they can cross lines, and we pursue industrialization. So, important decision here. The other decision that he makes, which is important to the future of American business, is something called the sanctity of contracts. Sanctity, you all spell that? Sanctity, it almost means the holiness, right? Sanctification, or these things are not to be broken. The reason that you want contracts not to be broken is because you want to know that if you enter into a contract with someone and that it is broken, you can go to a court and get an outcome to make the other person fulfill that contract. Later on, America is going to get investment from England and Europe in the tune of $8 billion. They've got to know that their money can go somewhere where, if they've got problems, they can sue in a court and get that money back. And the decisions of John Marshall in this case, Dartmouth College versus Woodward, does it. I'll quickly tell you what happens. Dartmouth College up here in Massachusetts has got a president of the college who's got a friend named Woodward. And the president gives Woodward a contract to supply something for the college for, like, ever. Well, the guy's a friend of the president of the college, and it's a sweetheart deal for Woodward. When the board of directors find out that Woodward is giving kickbacks to the president for this great contract, the board of directors, board of overseers of Dartmouth, fire the president. They then break the contract with Woodward. Woodward goes to the federal court system and sues for Dartmouth College to fulfill the terms of the contract. That goes all the way to the Supreme Court, and Mr. Marshall says that president of that college was duly authorized with agency power to commit the college board of trustees to these kind of arrangements. It may have been a stupid arrangement. It might even be wrong. The college might want to sue the president for this, but the terms are legitimate and the contract will be fulfilled. That sets the standard in America for the idea that if you enter a contract, you'd better be careful, because even if it's a stupid contract, it will be fulfilled by the court system. So the courts will protect commercial transactions and property. It makes a safe place and a secure place for business transactions. It's not some shenanigans where you pay a bribe to a judge, ideally, and they look the other way. These things will help make America a great place for business operations and investment by other countries to pour money into. Here is a land of great natural resources and a growing marketplace with goods and services, and billions of dollars of investments will come here, and we will go down the road of industrialization as we come into the 1850s and 60s with people like Andrew Carnegie, who will get all these bondsmen from England to buy it. But if we didn't have a safe place to get your money back, then the investment wouldn't have come here. So there's that. We're doing quite well on our ID list here. This is the end of the era of good feelings. I got 5 minutes left, and to get into this would really, I'd probably have to restate it all next time I see you.